Good afternoon, and welcome to the Johns Hopkins 30-minute COVID-19 briefing, where we provide live insights from the experts who lead our work at the Johns Hopkins Coronavirus Resource Center. For the next half hour, we'll focus on what you need to know right now about the COVID-19 pandemic and public health responses. As part of this briefing, we'll have an opportunity for live Q&A with our experts, and we'll be offering these 30-minute briefings regularly on Fridays at 12 p.m. But as we head into summer, I want to note that we will start to offer these briefings every other Friday. I'm Dr. Lainie Rutkow, a professor at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, and I'm part of the leadership team for the Johns Hopkins Coronavirus Resource Center. We'll be providing answers in real time today, so please submit your questions in the box that you see at the bottom of your screen. Before I turn to our two experts, I want to remind you that the Coronavirus Resource Center now offers a newsletter called The Week in COVID-19. This is a great way to get the latest analysis from our experts every Monday on topics including vaccines, variants, and other critical COVID-19 trends. Throughout this briefing, you'll see a banner on your screen and you can click on it to access the sign up for the newsletter. Today, I'm joined by two guests. First, Beth Blauer is Associate Vice Provost for Public Sector Innovation at Johns Hopkins University. She's going to give us an update about one of our newest efforts, the Pandemic Data Initiative. Then Dr. Bill Moss is Executive Director of the Johns Hopkins International Vaccine Access Center and a professor at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Bill will give us an update about COVID-19 vaccines. I'm now going to turn to each of our experts for a brief overview. Beth, first to you. You've now been immersed in COVID data for about a year and a half. How has the COVID data environment changed when you think about last summer compared to this summer?
Well, I think there's obviously lots to be excited about. We know that the data is looking really well, really good. We've made very, very important improvements in our response to the pandemic, and the data, it's manifesting in the data, we're seeing it. But we have at the Pandemic Data Initiative and through our work and examination, we've noticed a little bit of a troubling trend, which is that many states are making the decision now to sort of slow down how they're sharing data and the expression of that data. As you know, and as many users of our site know, we rely on public data that is provided by states and local governments to really power our infrastructure and to really give us that kind of granular view of how the disease is impacting communities. When that data is irregularly reported or when that data slows, it does certainly have an impact on our ability to spot trends, to invest public health resources effectively, to inform public policy, and all of those things are going to have a long-term impact on our capacity to respond and react, as we know that this is a very changing environment. We know by looking at the data that here in the United States, we are seeing those gains. We are seeing the effects of having a vaccination strategy. We are seeing really significant improvements year over year, especially on where it, and these are all, this is something to be very excited about, but we know that those gains are not shared globally. We know that there are many countries that are still really thinking and really constrained on their way that they can respond that don't necessarily have access to vaccination, and that's manifesting in the data. But even in a place like the United Kingdom, we're seeing a significant increase in cases as a new variant has really taken hold in that country. And that is in a place where there is a pretty widespread adoption of vaccination. And so this is why it's still very important for us to be keeping track of the data and why we're encouraging states to continue to commit to that sort of daily report so that as we look and see the sort of changing dynamic of the pandemic itself, we have the most up-to-date information and we can make the most up-to-date decisions.
Thanks so much, Beth. Before I turn to Bill, I want to remind our audience to please submit your questions for our experts in the box at the bottom of your screen. I do see your questions coming in. Bill, this week we've learned about US and other countries' plans to increase the number of vaccines that are being sent to other parts of the world. Despite this, we know that the vaccine rollout continues at an uneven pace throughout the globe. What do you see as the key vaccine developments over the last week or so?
Yes, thank you, Lainie. And it's been another busy week in news for around the COVID-19 vaccines. Let's start with the United States. So more than 305 million doses have been administered in the United States. That's tremendous progress. We've reached the milestone where just over 50% of those older than 12 years of age in the United States are now fully vaccinated. Three quarters, 75.8% of adults over 65 years of age now fully vaccinated. But that number also indicates that that halfway mark, if you will, of fully vaccinated individuals over 12 means that half of the US population is still not fully vaccinated. And this is our big challenge going forward. President Biden set a goal of 70% of those over 18 years of age receiving at least a single dose by July 4th. We're at 64%, and there are a lot of people who believe that at our current rate, we're not going to achieve that milestone. Our rate of vaccination is down. We peaked at a 7-day average of over 3 million vaccine doses being administered each day in early April. We're now, we've fallen below 1 million doses per day. So our pace of vaccination has slowed despite the fact that just about half of the US population over 12 years of age are not yet fully vaccinated. We're still seeing, obviously, disparities within the United States, racial disparities with Black Americans being vaccinated at a lower rate than white and Hispanic Americans. We're seeing geographic disparities with some states, particularly some states in the South, Mississippi, Alabama, Louisiana, really falling behind some of the leading states. And as we talked about last week, Lainie, we've seen some interesting incentives being rolled out. We talked about the lotteries, free beer in New Jersey, raffle for scholarships. I think my favorite of the past week or so is the Joints for Jabs program in Washington State, where you people can get a free marijuana joint with a COVID-19 vaccine. But there are some disturbing undertones of this. Is, you know, what does this really say about reasons why Americans are not getting vaccinated? If these kind of incentives can make a difference. Turning to the global situation, we see these inequities and disparities reflected on a much larger spatial scale. The G7 is pledging 1 billion COVID-19 doses today. Half of these doses, 500 million, will come from the United States. President Biden announced that the U.S. will purchase from Pfizer 500 million doses at a not-for-profit cost. These 500 million doses will be distributed through the COVAX facility, which, just as a reminder to everyone, this is the global mechanism established by the World Health Organization, Gavi, the Vaccine Alliance, and CEPI, the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, to really equitably distribute COVID-19 vaccines around the world according to population size. So this we're seeing, this is definitely progress. Just last week, Lainie, we were talking about, the plans for the United States to donate 25 million doses and how they were going to do that. Obviously, the Biden administration had previously pledged 80 million doses by the end of June, 60 million of those doses being the AstraZeneca vaccine, which is not even approved for or authorized for use in the United States. So this is a big step up from what we were seeing, talking about just last week, this 500 million doses and pledged by the United States, 200 million doses by the end of this year, 300 million doses early next year. But it's still far short of what is needed globally. And the Pfizer vaccine, it's a great vaccine, but it does have relatively stringent cold chain requirements. Just recently, the FDA said that the Pfizer vaccine can be stored for up to one month in a refrigerator. That's a change from just 5 days. So that's going to help a bit, that longer storage at the refrigerator temperatures. But that's still a challenge. And it, you know, let's say compares to the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, which can be stored up to 4.5 months in refrigerator temperatures. That too was just extended by 6 weeks. The World Health Organization estimates that 11 billion doses are going to be needed to vaccinate the world. I think, Lainie, last week we did that back of the envelope calculation, 8 billion people in the world, two doses, that's 16 billion. You aim to vaccinate about 70% of the world's population, you're around 11 billion. So 500 million pledged by the United States. Yes, it's a step in the right direction, but it still falls far short of what is needed. And the bottom line is that we have to increase vaccine manufacturing to really meet the global need. And this is so critically important, as highlighted by some recent data on what we now call the Delta variant. This is the variant that first was identified in India. Beth alluded to this. This is the variant that's causing the surge of infections in the United Kingdom. And it just shows us, I mean, we've been saying this, how if there's unchecked virus transmission, they provides the virus opportunities to mutate. Now we have a variant that's more transmissible, estimates of 60% more transmissible than the Alpha variant, which was the variant first identified in the United Kingdom. And it also is escaping some immunity. We have increasing evidence that people require higher levels of antibodies against SARS coronavirus 2 with this Delta variant. Study by the Public Health England suggests that even with the Pfizer vaccine, which is just 88% effective with two doses against the Delta variant, that drops to 33%, just one third after a single dose of the Pfizer vaccine. So that's telling us that in order to be protected against this Delta variant, we need higher antibody levels that are conferred by that second dose of the vaccine. And it really highlights the importance not only of addressing these global inequities, but getting two doses of the vaccine into the population. Just a few more points, Lainie. I want to highlight some of the news on the Pfizer vaccine and children. The Pfizer vaccine's begun their phase two, phase three study of children 5 to 11 years of age. They're hoping to apply for an emergency use authorization in younger children by September. But the big news, Lainie, is on the myocarditis and pericarditis. And we talked a little bit about this last week. Myocarditis and pericarditis, the myocarditis refers to inflammation of the heart muscle, pericarditis, the tissue around the heart. And there's increasing discussion about these conditions arising in young people after receipt of the Pfizer vaccination. And so there have been two published reports just this past week. Both their small case series, seven male adolescents each, one out of the United States, one out of Israel. But yesterday there was a hearing at the FDA of the Vaccines and Related Biological Products Advisory Committee, where the CDC reviewed the safety data and the signals that they're getting from the VAERS reporting system, which is our large national passive reporting system for vaccine adverse events. What we're learning is that it does appear that there is a higher risk or incidence of myocarditis or pericarditis in 16 to 24 year old individuals who've received, particularly after the second dose of a Pfizer or Moderna vaccine, the risk seems to be higher in males than females. About 80% of the reports were in boys or men. Median age of 24 years, so it's that kind of adolescent, young adults. Individuals are presenting with chest pain. They have elevated levels in their blood of cardiac enzymes. That's just reflection of that inflammation in the heart muscle. They're presenting, what's interesting to me, you know, within 4 days of receiving the vaccine. So this is an adverse event that occurs very, very rapidly after a vaccination. As I said, particularly that second dose, we still do not have definitive evidence that this is caused by the vaccine, but this is a very important safety signal. The Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices is scheduled to meet on June 18th to review this and further data and discuss the what should be done next in terms of one, understanding whether or not this is causally related to the vaccine, and what we should be doing about it. Two last points, Lainie. I want to highlight, we are seeing increasing reports of not only fake COVID vaccine cards that are being sold, but even fake COVID-19 vaccines in Africa. And it just shows how vulnerable countries may be to receiving fake vaccines, which is just really tragic. I'm gonna end very briefly on a positive note. One thing I'm very excited about in terms of new vaccines, some recent data on needle-free vaccines delivery. This is a technology I've been following for a number of years because in the measles field, we're very interested in this. These microarray patches, you just apply it to the skin. It's like a Band-Aid, has these little projections that introduces the vaccines into the skin where there are a lot of immune cells to respond. And we're beginning to see some positive animal model data using these patches. It would be a really game changer for delivering vaccines if we could just stick a little patch on the skin and be done with it. And I'll stop there, Lainie.
Thanks, Bill. That is so cool. I look forward to learning more. Before I turn to questions, and I do see lots of especially vaccine-related questions coming in today, I want to remind everyone that we do have a weekly newsletter called The Week in COVID-19. If you click on the banner that you see on your screen throughout this briefing, it'll take you to the sign up for it. It is a great way every Monday to get the latest analysis from our experts on topics including the virus itself, variants, and the latest trends from the data. I'm now going to move to questions that are coming in. And as I said, many of these pertain to vaccines. So Bill, I'm gonna start with you. Several questions coming in about the news out of FDA earlier today concerning the troubled emergent plant based in Baltimore. So FDA has now authorized release of about 10 million J&J doses from that plant, but also has told them that they will not be allowed to use approximately 60 million doses. So can you talk us through the implications of this decision?
Yes. Well, I mean, there are a number of them, and obviously there were problems at that plant in Baltimore, here in Baltimore, with contamination of doses. And so it's obviously very tragic that now an additional 60 million doses will have to be discarded because of the problems at this plant at a time when there's this huge global shortage of vaccines. So they have determined that 10 million doses are authorized for use. It's not yet clear to me whether those doses will be used in the United States or a part of, I haven't heard that they're part of a plan to export those doses. My sense is that those doses are now authorized for use in the United States. The FDA has not been, or the US government has not been distributing the J&J vaccine for some time now, and it makes up a relatively small proportion of the vaccine doses used in the United States. And so I think it it plays a small role, I think, here in the United States in terms of increasing the number of doses. We have to remember that there are important advantages of the J&J vaccine. I alluded earlier to the fact that it has a less stringent cold chain requirement. It can be refrigerated now for 4.5 months. That makes it much easier to kind of get that vaccine into remote areas. And obviously, it's a single dose. So there are certain populations, both here in the United States and globally, that would really benefit from a single dose of the vaccine. So there are still a strong argument for using that vaccine. But I guess my last point, Lainie, is that it just shows that creating these vaccines, these are complex biological products. And I said we have to scale up manufacturing, but that needs to be done very, very carefully. And we need to make sure that the vaccine doses that are manufactured around the world are done so with the highest quality.
Thanks, Bill. I'm going to stick with you and with the theme of the adenovirus vaccine. So another question that's come in concerning the clotting issues that we've heard about over the last several months for J&J and before that, AstraZeneca, how, if at all, could those concerns affect the timeline for authorization of the adenovirus vaccines in children? Is there any reason to think that this would transfer over to kids as a concern?
Yes. Yeah, so we are seeing, obviously, we saw the clotting disorders, and what was kind of unique in a way about the clotting disorder was that it was associated with low platelet counts. And there are actually a new report out of Scotland showing an autoimmune, what we call thrombocytopenia or low platelet count associated with the AstraZeneca vaccine. I think the short answer is we don't yet know whether that risk is going to be the same or different in younger children, but that's certainly something that we would need to look for in studies in younger children with both the J&J and the AstraZeneca vaccine. We don't yet know the answer to that. It's possible, it's possible either way. The risk could be very similar to older adults, or the risk could be decreased. I just don't know yet.
Thanks, Bill. Beth, I'm now going to turn to you. Can you talk us through how does state acquisition of data relate to the contact tracing process?
Yeah, so in a couple of different discrete ways, states use their case data and their hospitalization data as a way to see whether or not their contact tracing efforts are keeping pace with the level of disease that's in their communities. And so when we turn off that front end of the data, we then hamstring our efforts to be able to make sure that we are tracing the right cases, that we have enough contact tracing infrastructure in place to meet the current demand of the caseload. And then the work of the contact tracers is incredibly important for also making sure that the disease is contained, right? So we will be able to see whether or not the kind of outreach that happens during tracing actually has a suppressive effect on the disease. And so on the other end of the tracing, we look to see whether or not those practices are effective. And states and localities should be using that data to not only measure the efficacy of their contact tracing efforts, but also to make sure that they are robust enough and that they are being sort of dialed up and dialed down as it relates to the need that's being experienced in the community.
Thanks, Beth. So to ask a follow-up, then it sounds like if states have stopped their contact tracing efforts, does that compromise their ability to validate the data that they're getting?
I think it definitely, when we dial back any of this infrastructure, the big question is, how difficult was it to dial back up? So if we're in a situation where the Delta variant does come and really does kind of have the same effect as it's having on the UK, have we created a system where we can bring back online some of those resources that have been built up over the last year to make sure that we can stay ahead of the trend? I also think that it makes it harder to intervene with those kind of interventions that have been effective from the very beginning, even before we had vaccines. And so, public policy has been our sort of number one interrupter of the virus before we had the vaccine, and it's going to continue to be the lever that we're going to have to pull the most as we navigate this last mile. And contact tracing has been a big part of that public policy calculus. And so for those states that are dialing that down, the question is whether or not they see this infrastructure as temporary, or whether they see this as something that they can spin back up when the demand hits.
Thanks so much, Beth. Bill, getting a lot of questions about variants today, and especially the Delta variant. Can you talk us through where we are in terms of vaccines and variants with a particular focus on Delta?
Yeah, so, we're still learning more about the protective effectiveness of the vaccines against the Delta variant, which is the variant that was first identified in India. That's the most recently identified, variant of concern. And so the bottom line is that with particularly the Delta variant, it looks like the vaccines offer protection, and particularly protection against severe disease, hospitalizations, and deaths. And that's a really important point, and it's a positive point. However, it looks like with the Delta variant that we need higher levels of antibodies in order to be protected, higher levels of antibodies than we need, for example, with the Alpha variant, which is the variant that was first identified in the United Kingdom. And so the implications of that are, as I spoke to earlier, people need the second dose, for example, of the Pfizer Moderna vaccine, would be to really get the antibody levels up. It also raises potential concerns is if over time our antibodies wane, and we're still learning more about that timeline, we may need booster doses earlier as a consequence of a variant like the Delta variant, in order to maintain those very high antibody levels. Now, the Delta variant forms a relatively small percentage of the genetic variants in the United States right now, but obviously it's of concern, as Beth was saying, that variant could increase transmission as long as we have susceptible individuals in the United States. And so, unfortunately, that variant's going to get into, populations with low vaccination coverage, and that's where it's going to have the greatest burden.
Thanks, Bill. And I'll ask one final question. Lots of chatter about the potential for boosters. Any sense of what the timing for that might be?
Yeah, so I just picking up on my last few points. So, it's going to depend upon how quickly antibodies wane over time. We don't yet know that. We haven't seen significant waning. We haven't seen significant breakthrough infections in those who are fully immunized. But, and so that would be one driver of when we need booster doses. The other driver are the variants. And so, again, if the Delta variant really takes off in the United States, we may see booster doses earlier than we would have otherwise.
Thanks, Bill. We're coming up on 12:30, so I'm going to wrap. I'd like to thank Beth Blauer and Bill Moss for joining me today. Give a big thank you to everyone who joined us, and especially to those who submitted questions for our experts to answer. This briefing will be archived and available on coronavirus.jhu.edu. And as a reminder, we'll be offering these 30-minute briefings on Fridays at 12 p.m. But as I mentioned at the top of the briefing, as we head into summer, we're going to offer these briefings every other Friday. So that means that our next briefing will be Friday, June 25th at 12 p.m. As always, in each briefing, we'll focus on what you need to know right now about the COVID-19 pandemic, and we'll have live Q&A with our experts. I look forward to seeing you at our next 30-minute briefing. And until then, thanks and stay safe.